March 1943. The Red Army's great victory at Stalingrad has lit a beacon of hope for the Soviet people. The tide of war is turning. At last, Stalin's troops begin the long drive west. Even the very young are swept up in a new wave of popular determination. For these children, orphaned by war, the Soviet motherland is their only parent. When the time comes, they are prepared to stand and fight alongside their fellow countrymen and defend her to the last. Their childhood dreams sacrificed at the altar of war. These boys yearn only to join the victorious troops they idolize. What can they know of the dull, squalid reality that is frontline existence, punctuated only by moments of terror and horror? Little boys, no more than 8 or 9 years old, flock to new military schools all over the Soviet Union. Like the Alexander Suvorov Academy, named after Catherine the Great's favorite general. Here, they are groomed for battle, schooled in military drill, spoon-fed the ideal of patriotic self-sacrifice. These boys are lucky. This war will be over before they're big enough to wield machine guns or steer tanks into enemy fire. But time and age are not on the side of these recruits. Though they have fought and survived the Battle of Stalingrad, their commanders can permit them no rest. Instead, they must struggle on through the late winter blizzards, instruments of their supreme commander's lust for glory. Stalin has sampled victory at Stalingrad, and he wants to taste it again. He cares nothing for the lives of ordinary soldiers. He is bent only on burnishing his name with the luster reserved for history's mightiest warlords. From early February, Stalin orders new offensives all along the southern fronts. The Red Army drives deep into Nazi-held territories, fighting exhaustion, cold, mud. And in the skies, the protective umbrella of the Red Air Force, beating back Luftwaffe resistance and pounding German troop positions. Inch by inch, the infantry advances. Reclaiming lands devastated by retreating Germans. Rescuing communities shattered by the agonies of occupation. Now it is safe to come out of hiding. And there is work to be done in the newly liberated lands. Children must be fed. And they must be schooled, taught something of life among the ruins. But for older children, the call to war is irresistible. At the Red Navy's Northern Fleet School, some cadets already wear battle decorations. Soviet youth is champing at the bit, signaling its readiness for the fight against Germany. Red Army recruits board their trains for the front in the spring of 1943. They are destined to take part in one of history's bloodiest battles. Russian author Bulat Okudzhawa was among them.
Мы едем на фронт впервые. Я весь сотрясаю, я не могу спать.
We were on our way to the front for the first time. I was shivering all over and I couldn't get any sleep on the troop train. I couldn't sleep because I was on my way to fight at the front. They issued us with a carbine each, as well as a uniform. So I had a carbine and an ammunition belt. Everyone was asleep, but I couldn't sleep. Finally, the train stopped somewhere in the middle of the night, and I climbed out of my carriage, out of the cattle truck, and started to walk the length of it, up and down with my carbine at the ready, although nobody had given me an order to do this. Later, I was stopped and told to go and get some sleep, but I couldn't. I had to play the part of a real soldier.
He is not alone. Many share his anxiety and anticipation. They all realize the Red Army is being built up for a massive offensive. Former paratrooper Konstantin Vanchenkin.
The army was getting younger, and with each year, the interval between drafts got shorter and shorter. For example, I was called up in year